What a good game, McKay. Alistair and Jamie enjoyed it, and I'm sure they learnt a lot.
If a player who is young goes out and watches a good player play, they can pick up an awful lot of pointers, their tactics and the way they hit the ball. And I think that's one way to really help yourself as much as you can.
What advice would you give these boys who are only beginners, Fraser?
Lord Aberdare, I think the first and most important thing is for the child to have a racket that is not very heavy. If he or she uses a racket that is too heavy, they tend to fall into bad habits.
I certainly think that first thing they should do is try and find someone who has played the game before, and this person could show them the right grips to use on the different strokes, the right way to swing the racket, and as Neil said, could help them pick out a racket that would fit them suitably for weight and balance.
Mr. Hopman, as coach to many successful Australian Davis Cup teams, what advice can you give the boys? Equipment, for example. Is it necessary to have a good pair of shoes?
Well, I would say no, and I speak with quite a lot of authority on that question, because I was mad on soccer football till the age of 13, and I used to play soccer football barefooted, and I played tennis barefooted. Therefore, I would say that the shoes are not necessary at that age. I don't think you'd get onto the Wimbledon centre court without them. But for youngsters learning the game, well, I don't think they need worry much about shoes, except to know that they're comfortable.
What do you think's the most important thing for young tennis players to remember, McKay?
I think one of the most important things is that you should keep your eye on the ball until it hits the racket.
After that, a very important thing is footwork. If you watch a lot of good players, you'll find that their feet are always in the right position to hit the ball, which allows them the rhythm and control and power to place the ball where they want it.
And what do you think, Lou?
Well, I feel that the best possible type of practice that you can have is to play against two players, as we used to do when I was an amateur playing with Harry Hopman. Wherever you hit the ball, it's always sure to come back. And in this way, you get a good workout. Also, in practice, I feel that you have to play, or try and play, with players who are better than yourself. And also, if you have any weak strokes, such as a backhand or overhead smash, or a forehand, to practice the strokes which are the weakest.
There's one thing I'd like to stress, and that is the matter of practice facilities. I've often heard people say, oh, I can't practice because there's no court available. It's not a very difficult thing to build a practice tennis wall. Even at a club where the adults want to monopolize the courts most of the time. Now, every shot in the game, and footwork and all that sort of thing, can be practiced by hitting on a wall. So there's no excuse for young people if there are no courts available. They can learn to play tennis by hitting in the park or hitting against a wall at home.
Having learnt the basic strokes, how do you play the so-called big game of serve, volley and smash? Your game's a good example, Fraser. What advice would you give the boys?
Practice a lot and train a lot. If they've got a good forehand, they've got to make it better. If they've got a good serve, they've got to make it even better still, until they reach international standard.
The basis of the big game, of course, is the service. Can you give us some advice on serving, McKay?
I think the main thing about serving is to get as much rhythm into the stroke and into the action as you can, to throw the ball up a bit in front of you so that you get the weight of your body into the serve. The small person can certainly have a very powerful serve. It's all in the rhythm and the way that they get their body weight into the ball.
Lou Hode, he's only about 5'11", I think, or 5'10 and a half, and well, if everyone had a serve like him, it'd be interesting.
Well, I feel that the first serve is possibly the most important stroke in tennis, because if you get the ball into play, then it automatically forces your opponent onto the defensive and you take a commanding position at net. If you miss your first serve, when you're playing a fellow like Gonzalez, you automatically put yourself on the defensive, because then he takes complete command of the second serve, because you have to slow the ball up to get it into court, and he has time to run around and hit any shot he likes to hit.
What about a second serve, Fraser?
I think a second serve is very important. If you know you've got a good second serve, you can take a lot of chances on your first serve and make a lot of outright winners.
And do you think that help from older, more experienced players is essential, Mr. Hopman?
I know that Australian youngsters like Sedgman McGregor, Hode Rosewall, Cooper Anderson received a tremendous amount of help from older players who had been through the mill, so to speak, and were able to cram 10 or 12 years' experience of court craft, tactics, and temperament in the matter of 2 or 3 years.
Do you think these boys stand a chance of becoming champions one day?
I am a great believer that champions, or most champions, are made rather than born.
Do you look for tough physical qualities in a potential champion?
I would think that you don't have to find a very hearty-looking boy to say, well, now that's a champion. Physique and stamina, for instance, can be manufactured. Take Frank Sedgman's case. Sedgman was playing in a school tournament when I saw him. He was aged 12 and he had nothing more than a nice smile and was pigeon-toed and he loved the game. At 16, he was stoop-shouldered and unathletic. He went to a gymnasium and in 18 months had built into the fine-looking specimen you see of Sedgman playing on the courts today.
I always admire the way you all keep trying, even when you're being beaten.
Well, no matter how far down you might be, the score allows for you to come back and you've got to keep trying all the time because things can go your way all of a sudden just like they've been going your opponent's way.
Well, thank you all very much indeed. Well, boys, that's given you a lot to think about. Do your best, and whether you win or lose, don't be downhearted. Look what's written over the entrance to the center court. It's a quotation from a poem by Rudyard Kipling called If. Can you read it, Alistair?
If you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat these two impostors just the same,